is a second in today. And as I was mentioning in my previous round, I think you really need to now sort of collectively sit down and think which of all of these things you want to do with the paper. But I want to emphasize, as I did in the previous time around, that I don't think that it's realistic that you're going to be able to focus on all of the topics that are right now coming through the paper. All of them are very interesting, and I wouldn't necessarily be able to say which one shows more promise. I think you need to make strategic choices which are relating both to the fit in the special issue and then a conversation with Santi and Marie toward, in relation to how the special issue will be developing in terms of whether there will be a single theme or a set of themes that will be given priority in the special issue might be one of the things or the aspects to inform your choices of what you have there in the paper. If there's no very strong directionality by the editors on the topics or the themes that you would want to focus on, you might want to consider from a strategical point of view whether you want to prioritize first giving readers a first generic but focused sense of the data that you have. And from that point of view, you might want to focus on descriptive and substantive representation although I think you don't have enough material to deal with substantive representation, and I think that that's a separate point that you need to consider, but there might be some scope to try to do something about descriptive representation of the Latino population and how that links perhaps not with substantive representation per se, but with perceived roles of representation, which is something that it's a sort of a bridging element between descriptive and substantive representation for the Latino population. If you do that, again, what I would encourage is that you start with a very one, ideally, or several, but then they need to be very intimately related, set of theoretically oriented questions or puzzles. And then you need to actually carry that one across the paper. I don't think that it will work to try to combine elements of the effects of selection methods and recruitment methods with all of the material that you have about descriptive representation and perceptions of the roles of representation. I don't think that you can actually condense all of these literatures in a single 8,000 words paper. So you might want to discuss as a group also whether what you would want strategically to do, which might be an idea, is to think about writing a full book in Spanish about the various waves of the survey, like a proper book, not just a report like we did with the CIS some years ago, where you're describing in detail all of these aspects that you're interested in the two papers, but for the article, focus a little bit more. So, as I was saying before, the other aspect that I think you need to focus on is how much you're circumscribing this paper on Latinos, which is always sort of an easy balance in the paper right now, because you want to focus on Latinos, but you're bringing all of the time comparisons with other groups, and that becomes very confusing to the reader. So I think that if you're going to focus on Latinos, then in my opinion, I think you need to forget about the data that you have on the rest of the groups, which is very interesting, but you're not necessarily going to be able to mobilize it in an effective way. You can mention in the description of the data that data were collected about these other groups as well, but just stop there and not try to bring in comparisons with the other groups all of the time, because otherwise then you're going to be focusing, you're going to lose the focus on Latinos, and you then need to bring a lot of other factors and dimensions that are very difficult to accommodate. From this point of view, however, I think that one of the intrinsic limitations that you will have is that your data ultimately is only, if I understood correctly, coming from 25 respondents, right? So this is 25 respondent candidates, if I understood correctly, not councillors, but the candidates. So you have even less. All of them are councillors.
Yeah.
So, okay, but you do have more candidates then?
No.
No. So it's both candidates and councillors?
Yeah.
Only 25?
Yeah.
Okay, that's weird. There should be a lot more candidates that never
yeah,
were
yeah.
elected.
Okay,
so okay.
We have
problems in
reaching
the non-elected candidates, okay.
Yeah. But, well, in fact, the paper has a little information.
Okay. Okay. So I think that that's, well, as I said in the previous round of feedback, that was never very clear to me whether they were candidates or councillors, and I understand now that it's because it's both. That they were in both, and you didn't have more than the 25, because in my mind I was expecting at least, I don't know, 70, 80 Latin American candidates. So then, of course, doing analysis with 25 is going to be always intrinsically problematic. So then you might have to reconsider whether actually focusing on Latinos is strategically possible at all or not. And that's something I'm not sure I can advise you on that. You will need to think about that, but you're going to have a very hard time. Well, certainly having a quantitative paper on N25, even if you're comparing them to the non-Latinos, whether that's other migrant origin candidates or the Spanish natives, it's going to be intrinsically problematic for most of your blind reviewers. So, and I understand then that the qualitative work stems from this limitation, but then I'm not sure. I'm not sure that you have enough material that is showing, at least in the current version, that would actually justify the focus on Latinos only either. So I think you will need to rethink strategically whether you can actually successfully work around the limitations that have sort of come your way because of field work on focusing on the Latino candidates. And I don't know if there are realistic alternatives, like trying to identify those that were mentioned by the political parties as of Latin American origin, and perhaps trying to access them in a qualitative way through various means. I don't know whether that's realistic or not. But then you might have to reconsider the focus on Latinos. As I was saying also, there is this mismatch between the introduction and the first parts of the theoretical framework, and this is the part where I don't think that the whole discussion on the role of primaries as selection method is really going to sit very well with the whole discussion about the descriptive representation and who the migrants, so the Latino candidates and councillors are, and what their views about representation really are, because the discussion about candidate selection methods drives you to a literature which is very specific and which is sitting in electoral and sort of party politics scholarship, that it's very narrow in a certain sense in terms of the factors that it's considering. And merging that one with the literature on descriptive representation and views and roles about representation is going to be very, very hard. So the alternative would be to have a paper only on how candidate selection methods might affect the selection of, but perhaps not only the Latinos, but the various groups. Are candidate selection methods driving selection outcomes differently for the different communities? And in that case, I don't see a reason why you would focus on the Latino community in particular. I don't see a very powerful reason why you would expect candidate selection methods necessarily to be operating in a different way for Latinos than for the others, unless you theorize about it. Unless you theorize about perhaps certain dynamics of prejudice that might mean that if candidates are being selected through primaries, then perhaps the Moroccan or the Romanians may face more prejudice than, for example, the Latin Americans, which are perceived by the Spanish natives as closer culturally and socially. But you would have to theorize about what your expectations are of the candidate selection methods affecting outcomes differently for different groups. But I cannot really see why something focusing only on the Latino community and selection methods would give you a very interesting puzzle to start with. So that's something perhaps to think about. And as I was discussing in the previous round, then the strategy would be to try to narrow down the theoretical framework and make it a lot less dispersed, so that you can try to reduce very much the number of sort of hypotheses or expectations or theoretical propositions that you're wanting to test. Increasingly, I think it's always been a little bit like that, but increasingly my perception with journal reviews is that, especially because journals are going more and more towards shorter 1,000 words papers, they want papers that really are addressing one, two hypotheses at the most. So anything that goes beyond a couple of hypotheses or expectations that you're testing is going to have a very hard time getting published or otherwise, that sort of review process is going to be quite prolonged. So I think you need to try to concentrate your focus on one or two things at a time. I think those are the generic comments, the detailed comments. You have them already from the previous round of the conference. I'll focus on the paper by Santi Berneras and colleagues. As I was also mentioning, I think this is, again, a paper that is in a very similar situation in that it's very understandable at this first stage after the project has finished, so there's nothing. And actually, for those of us who are interested in looking at how the results have panned out, it's quite interesting to be able to see the descriptive results. But what you will need to choose, again, is which areas you want to prioritize. And as I was saying, there are here for me at least, if not more, two papers. One which is around the numbers and the type of groups and the demographics of descriptive representation on the one hand, and what are the socio-demographic dynamics that might lead through mobilization to certain outcomes of descriptive representation. And then what I think is a relatively different paper, which is focusing on party competition and party dynamics. And my impression is that you have a lot more in terms of development at this stage, in terms of review of the literature, a lot more going on right now on the numbers matter, size matters, the characteristics of the groups matter, than on the political party storyline. So strategically, I think you're better off perhaps prioritizing the paper around the size of the groups and the composition of the groups and their geographical concentration, and leaving the party competition story for a different paper. Because, I mean, especially given that at least the simple way of looking at party competition, which is the fragmentation of the party system, is not really yielding much of a result at this stage. And neither is the left-right divide in a simple way of portraying it. So then, from a very pragmatic point of view, that's what I would probably suggest. From that point of view, then, the theoretical focus can be on what's the role of residential concern. And you will have to choose some of them. I don't think that you can actually cover all of them either in a single paper. So you will have to see whether you want to emphasize issues relating to residential concentration and the type of migration flow, and link to this the whole discussion about the comparative advantage of the Latin Americans. But even then, the whole discussion about gender, citizenship, and electoral rules might complicate matters too much. In that, again, as soon as you introduce gender, then you have to review all this literature about intersectionality, which is a very complex literature to review, and which doesn't necessarily match very well with the whole literature on residential concentration and group mobilization. So from again, a strategic and very pragmatic point of view, I think you're better off trying to reduce complexity and perhaps going through the review about the strengthening numbers kind of argument, or some variant around it. In terms of the data, I already mentioned that I think that one of the critical choices that you will have, and this is not an easy choice, is, again, what is the unit of analysis? So whether you're going to look at outcomes at the municipality level, so if you have a given, so let's say that you were going to focus on some variant of the kind of socio-demographic composition kind of argument, and you want to look at what's the size of the groups and what are the composition, and maybe even how many of them already have Spanish nationality and hence can act as voting blocks in this, is your outcome going to be at the municipality level? So how many candidates or elected representatives, because that's the other choice that you need to be making, have actually made it to the list of the parties given, because there are two ways of viewing the whole descriptive representation process. Is it incumbent upon any given individual party, or are we expecting parties in the aggregate as a party system to represent the citizens? And then it's not a problem if the Popular Party is focusing on the Romanians and the Socialist Party and Podemos and United Left are focusing on the Moroccans and the Latin Americans, if at the end of the process then political parties are representing their populations in a more or less reasonable way. So then there would be a strong case to argue that you should be looking at the municipality level as the outcome that it's of interest. But another way of viewing it would be to actually look at the political parties as each list as the place where those dynamics should be operating as well. And then you need to be perhaps making arguments about the selectivity of the different parties without getting too much in detail about them. But an alternative way of looking at things, if you're going instead to be looking at characteristics of the candidates or the councillors on which you have more information, perhaps, is to take individual candidates as the unit of analysis and for every single list, and then look at the different characteristics of both the native Spanish and the immigrant origin characteristics, and how these contextual factors might be driving the final composition of the individual candidates. But all of these analyses will take you in very different directions, and what you can do with the data will vary substantially depending on which unit of analysis you're deciding. And what I would say perhaps at this stage is I would really discourage you from shifting the unit of analysis in the same paper, because again, in a short piece for a journal article, your readers are bound to get confused if you're shifting from And I'm sorry now to get very pragmatic, but publishing articles is about persuading your reviewers, and increasingly reviewers are sending reviews with the relatively superficial reading or very quick one, because they're very pressed with time. So if you start shifting the focus of analysis and the unit of analysis around the paper, then they will get confused, because they're not going to spend really 4 hours on reviewing the paper, even if they should, but they won't. So I think we all need to play with real rules of the game right now. And that goes, the unit of analysis also linked to what is the main dependent variable, whether it's position on the list or whether it's being selected as a candidate, or whether the outcome variable is having been elected as a counselor, or whether the dependent variable is the percentage in an aggregate level of candidates or of elected counselors. And different choices will restrict you differently in terms of the data that you have, because you don't have the same, from my knowledge of how the project data collection has been structured, you don't have the same type of information for all of those units of analysis and all of those dependent variables. So you really need to make those strategic decisions very early on and write the paper on the basis of one single decision and the limitations that it imposes you. Okay, finally, for Larissa's paper, so this is a very interesting paper with a very interesting focus on the use of arts by Mexican migrants in Brussels as a form of political transnational engagement. And I find that the introduction very convincingly identifies a gap in knowledge about how the Mexican diaspora is reacting to the recent and enduring waves of violence in Mexico, which, as you point, is quite surprising given the number of scholars that actually have been working on the Mexican community, at least in the U.S., for a very long time. I wanted to start by congratulating you, because it's really very well written, and especially when I heard now in your presentation that you're still doing your PhD, I say, wow, kudos, because it really read as if this was written by a postdoc researcher. So very well done. It is, I don't know if it's the first or the second or the third draft, but it's a really very strong draft in the way that it's written. And I would say that my comments are not necessarily about what you do say in the paper, but about all of the things that you don't say. So the introduction, for example, is very well written. It flows very well in relation to the discussion of the existing scholarship on transnationalism and diasporas, and specifically on the study of artistic expression for political mobilization. However, one of the things that I was lacking in the introduction and more generally in the rest of the article was addressing the key question that should motivate the reader. In terms of the relevance of this research. And as a political scientist interested in political mobilization by migrants and by diasporas, the main question, and as being also a very mainstream political scientist, I should say that as a disclaimer from the starting point, what I was still lacking was answering how or in what ways are artistic forms of expression consequential for political mobilization, transnational or otherwise. What I could not really get as a political scientist is why should I care? Why should I care about whether the Mexican diasporas throw music parties or are doing photographic exhibitions or are doing painting or any other sort of music festival? What does it tell me about the political process, their capacity to influence it, or their attempts even to influence it? So what I was missing here is what is it that is critical for our understanding of political transnationalism that we would miss if your study was not published? What is it that we would really not know if the reviewers rejected your paper? And you need to make that argument of why. This is not just interesting, which I agree it is. Actually, what I read, and it was an engaging piece to read, and I thought, oh, this is so interesting. But interesting in a sort of kind of very abstract, non-specific way. It was a bit as if you're telling me a fascinating story, but none that I could really connect to consequentiality in terms of how does this matter for the capacity of the Mexican communities to have their voices heard, or at least getting a better chance at having their voices heard by European institutions or by the national political system in Belgium or even the Mexican ones. So this is where I think there's a difference between arguing that something is interesting and arguing that something is important for understanding of a given phenomenon. And in this case, it would be political mobilization. And I think you really need to make that case, and that the study will be much more robust and persuasive if you can actually argue that. But this is consequential and an important contribution to understanding how diasporas are mobilizing politically. So then your theory section is really summarizing very well the core of the literature on political transnationalism, but I think that similarly to this kind of missing point that I was finding in the introduction, I think that your literature review takes for granted too quickly that all readers would agree that artistic expressions of dissent form part of the subset of actions that we would consider political participation or political engagement. And I should warn you that this will not be the case. At the end of the day, who is your reviewer will be a lottery, but chances are that you may get a mainstream political scientist like me, and it would not be obvious at all that some of the instances of events and activities that you're describing count as forms of political participation or engagement. So I think that here you need to work a bit more also on the definition. So you're using a definition of immigrant political transnationalism, specifically Martinello and Lafleur's, that actually requires that the activities are aimed at gaining political power or influence. And that's the definition that you give us. It's not necessarily even the most popular one, but I don't have an issue with the one by Martinello and Lafleur. But I don't think that you follow the definition necessarily in the selection of activities, because a lot of the activities that you're describing, the primary aim is not to gain political power or influence at all. That might be, I'm not even sure it's a side effect of those activities. They are having perhaps other side effects that can be sort of identified as forming part of the political realm or the realm of politicizing the communities and the diaspora, but in themselves, in and of themselves, they're not really aimed at gaining political power or influence, at least several of the ones that you describe in the paper. So if your focus is on transnational political participation, and if you wish to argue that artistic forms of protest are forms of political participation, I think you really ideally need to link the discussion in the paper around the concept of political participation in mainstream political science and political sociology. So not only in the transnationalism literature, which very often does not necessarily link their work with the mainstream political participation studies in political science and political sociology. So starting from Verba, Schlossman and Brady and the various co-authors that they have had. And you can depart from that literature. I'm not suggesting that you need to follow strictly their definitions, but at least I think you need to engage with the mainstream literature and political participation and argue why you're departing from it and why you think a wider notion of political participation needs to be embraced. And if you're espousing such a wider notion, I think you need to justify it. Also related to this and the literature review, I think that it's, for me, it's not fully clear that the focus of your analysis is strictly going to be on social movements. So as such, the whole discussion that you have around the social movements literature was a little bit confusing to me. If you keep it, I think you should integrate it with the previous literature review that you're doing rather than having a separate section for it, because I could not really see how this... I think I understand where you're coming from in terms of why the social movements literature is relevant, because it has being quite much more developed in terms of the emphasis of the importance of emotions and symbolism and identity through a wider range of expressions of what is political and what are the boundaries between the political and the non-political. But in reality, you never really argue, and I think it would be difficult to argue, that what you're studying is really a social movement. You're studying instances of collective action by a certain ethnic community, which I would argue, at least from your depictions, does not seem to constitute a social movement proper as such. But we should not think that not being a social movement is in any way sort of second class. You don't need to be upgraded into a social movement for your collective action to be meaningful or even consequential. But right now, this separate discussion of the social movement literature, in my view, does not sit very well with what you want. And I don't think you need it. I mean, you can bring in elements of the social movement literature when they're useful for you in the literature review without having to sort of reserve a space for it separately. So in reality, a general point that I would have would be that the whole build-up of the article left me wondering, why would you want to focus on artistic expressions of protest and discontent per se, instead of focusing first on what most of your readers, or at least some, I can't really know whether it would be most or some, might perceive as more consequential forms of unconventional political participation. So all forms of demonstrations, of organizing and signing petitions, other forms of expressive and contentious collective action. So I think that at some point you will need to address this expectation that probably your reader would want to know about sort of the wider set of expressions within which the artistic ones are a subset of, and unless you make a case for it that for this particular set of or wave of contention or for this particular community, then artistic expressions are very powerful in the repertoire, which it might be, but you would need to show us. I think it would perhaps be better for us to understand what's the overall picture of the contention and the mobilization that is being generated by the Mexican community. So even if you're not focusing on it, then at least it might be useful if you can describe to us what this wave of contention and mobilization looks like, how many demonstrations have happened in this period, with which following, with which sequence or timing, and if you can have some sense, even if it's not quantitative, of how many of them actually are with a repertoire that is highly artistic, if you can make a case that actually art is really very important in the way that the Mexican community is expressing their grievances, then that will be a very strong justification. In relation to the methods, I think that you really need to provide a clearer, a justification, because you don't provide it right now, of case selection. So why, among all of the possible cases in Europe, have you chosen Belgium or Brussels? It was not clear to me whether it was Belgium or it was only Brussels, and I think that you also need to make that clear. Because as far as I know, Belgium is not in any way the European country with the largest concentration of Mexican migrants. So my understanding is that Spain is the first, but then Germany is the second, and France is the third. So I'm not really sure whether Belgium comes fourth or fifth, but it's certainly not one of the three top destination countries. So that the Belgian choice is not obvious at all. And you never tell us what's the size of the Mexican community in Belgium. So if it's really very tiny, which I suspect it might be in terms of size, then this might have important consequences in terms of how, what sort of effects it might have in how well-knit it is. Smaller communities could actually working in two ways. If they are residentially concentrated in the same space, then they can be very closely knit. But if they're very, very small and they're very dispersed in the territory, then they might actually be extremely fragmented and not work as a diaspora community effectively. So I think that you need to tell us more about that. I understood from your presentation today that actually your dissertation compares France and Belgium. But even with those two choices, they're not the most obvious, because from a numerical point of view, you would want to compare Spain and Germany. So, for example, which are the top two. So I think you need to provide us with that understanding. In terms of the findings discussion, it was, again, very easy to read, and it flows very nicely, so I don't have criticisms on the way that you've actually presented your findings and discussion. But I found that some of the selected quotes were referring to motivations to become politically active in general, and they were not specific to artistic expressions. So that part sometimes confused me about what it is that you're telling us about the whole process of becoming politicized or mobilized, that it's intrinsic or specific to the artistic side of your story or to becoming politically active, full stop. So I would find it useful if you can perhaps distinguish in the analysis between events where the core activity is the artistic one versus those where the artistic expression is just simply accompanying a non-artistic core mobilization activity. So I find that there is a difference, for example, in the some of the mobilizations that you describe, that there is a difference for me in terms of the meaning of the mobilization when you were saying there's these demonstrations in EU institutions in Brussels where pictures of the disappeared school boys and girls in Mexico were being shown. Art there is an instrumental sort of a tool that it's in a way accessory. You can or cannot use it for the main purpose of the activity. You could do that demonstration as well without the pictures as such. Of course, the pictures add a very powerful symbolic language to the demonstration, but it's not the main purpose, it's not the artistic activity as such. Whereas, for example, all of the descriptions and quotes that you were referring to in relation to your interviewee that was organizing this music, the song, I can't remember the other way, but the thing that you said was similar to flamenco. I think that that's a different kind of activity altogether. The main purpose of that activity is their artistic expression and political awareness, in a sense, because there's no mobilization as such there. There's political awareness. Is an intended byproduct of that artistic expression, but the main focus of the activity is the artistic expression as such. So I think that the role of art is very different in one and the other, and I'm not sure you can analyze them in the same way simultaneously, or at least I had trouble seeing the meaning of analyzing both of them simultaneously. And to conclude, I understand that one of the goals in your paper is to bring in this concept of subjectivity. But I have to say, after reading the whole paper, I was not sure I got a clear sense of how the subjectivity developed in these forms of action in any different way to how subjectivity would be formed through political mobilization without artistic expression. So I'm not saying that I could not see subjectivity in your analysis and in your findings. What I cannot see is a subjectivity process or subjectivity formation process that it's any different to the one that I would identify in any process of political mobilization that is not artistic per se. So I was not able to identify what's the added value of focusing on the artistic expression part of the story. And I think that you need to work on that, whether that's by systematically comparing a subjectivity process through artistic mobilization and through non-artistic mobilization, or in some other way, but it didn't sort of come out very clearly to me. Other than that, as I said, I really enjoyed reading the paper. It was really a very interesting paper to read, and as I said, it was very clearly and very well written. So I hope that these comments would help you in some way to make it stronger.